All right. Come on in.
I don't own the right to this music. This is the best day of our lives. Potter's House of Denver. All right, I see you digging Price. Hey, Brother Tyrone. Bless you, sir. Hey, Virginia. Brother Thomas, bless you. Good to see you all on. Hey, Pastor March. Bless you, sir. All right. Hadn't seen you, man, in a couple of days. Hope things are well. Hey, it's with the Gloria. God bless you. Good to see you. Hey, I'm Hattie. Bless your heart. I see you. I see you. It's Yvette. I see you. Where you been? I ain't seen you yesterday. You say hi now. That's right. Come on, declare it. Hey, my mother. Hey, Marie. This is my Hawaii shirt. Thank you. Beat it. Okay, it's my anyway. That's it. Come on in. You come in. Ask you to please share our page. Pastor Dawson, bless you. Good to see you. Hey, Ken. How are you? Pastor Karen, bless you. Y'all come on in. We can go on about 90 seconds. Good evening. Wonder Bird is wonderful. I ain't sure what that is, but okay. Hey, Mississippi in the house. How are you? All right. That's right. Oh, yeah. Y'all calling in again. Ask you to share our page. Hey, Sharon. Good to see you. Minister of Georgia, I see you. Y'all come on in. As you come in, please share our page. Invite your family in. Come on. Let's get this page loaded tonight. The word gonna be good tonight, I promise you. It's going to be good tonight. All right. This is the day the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Hey, Minister Gina. Listen, as always, we pray you guys had a great day today. Thank God we all made it through another holiday weekend. I pray you guys had fun and enjoy yourself with your family. And I pray that you all invited God into the equation. I tell you what, man, listen, if you missed yesterday, you missed a great lesson on yesterday. It was powerful. As always, I would encourage you. Hey, Elder. As always, I'd encourage you to go back. Minister Gina, I see you. As always, I encourage you to go back and watch yesterday's stream. Oh, my God, it was great. We're going to give you part two of that same lesson on Sunday. And I pray that it blessed your life on next week, if the Lord say the same, as it did us on this Sunday. And so, again, I pray that you can make it out to the sanctuary on next Sunday and allow your heart to be blessed by the word of God. Listen, y'all, the word of God is quick, it's powerful. It is sharper than any two-edged sword. And we thank God for the word because the word is, listen, the word is rich. And the word is designed to heal us. It is designed to keep us. It's designed to make us whole. And so we thank God for what he is doing and what he has done. All right, let's pray and let's get into the word tonight. I'm ready to jump right into the word. Father, thank you again for those who have tuned tonight. Hey, bless you, Pastor White. God bless you. I see you, sir. Thank you, Father, for those who are tuning in tonight. We pray tonight that as we dig into your word, we pray that you would bless our time together. We thank you and give your name maximum glory. It's in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Sister Barbara Jean Robinson, bless you. God, I see you. All right, all right. And so we pray that you all are ready for the word tonight. All right. Good to see you too, sir. Absolutely. Hey, y'all, you see in the feed, BJ White, this man, I tell you what, this is a preacher here. This brother can just get it. I love this man. This man can just preach. All right. Good to see y'all. Come on in. That's right. You all chiming in quick today. Bless y'all heart. All right. Listen, go to Psalm 139. Psalm 139. Look at verse 14. Psalm 39, verse 14. I see you, Deke. How are you, Elder? Good to see you. Psalm 139, let's look at verse 14. It says, I will praise thee, for I am wonderfully and fearfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. I want to take our lesson tonight out of the A part of this verse. Let me give it to you again. It says, I will praise thee, right here, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Tonight, I want to resume our lesson we started on last week. And it is important that we all understand our uniqueness and our position as it pertains to the plans of God for our lives and the kingdom of God. And this is important because we're dealing with designer's original. And this does us no good if we don't understand, you all, our uniqueness. Right. And that God has called all of us to our own individual and unique positions. One of the things I said last week was like a snowflake, none of us are the same. And God has made all of us unique. And he's given all of us different positions. For some of us, our positions, the title of our positions may be the same. But even in the same title, God has given us different regions and he has caused us to be effective in the sphere in which he set us in. And so therein caused us to be unique in our own way. Listen, the people that you've been called to reach, no one can reach them but you. The people God has called you to touch, God has called you to touch those people in the area in which you serve. And so we must then understand our uniqueness and the call to which God has called us to do. And I believe, you all, that one of the reasons we have lost so many battles against the devil is for our lack of awareness. You see, you can't be what you don't know you are. You can't become what you don't know you should be becoming. And we find ourselves losing many battles to the enemy because of our lack of awareness of who we are and who you and I belong to. As a matter of fact, Hosea said it this way, Hosea 4, verse 6, the A part of the verse. Hosea declared, Hosea said, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge, right? He said, they are destroyed for lack of knowledge. And many of us, you all, are out of position because of a lack of knowledge. We don't know who we are and who we've been called to be because of a lack of knowledge. The Good News translation said this way. It says, my people are doomed because they don't acknowledge me. Isn't that amazing? Even this declaring that you are doomed because you don't acknowledge or have an awareness of who God is. But then the Young's literal translation says this. It says, cut off have been my people for lack of knowledge. Isn't that amazing? We've been cut off from what? We've been cut off from the things, from the possibilities that come through our salvation because of our lack of knowledge. Now, tonight, you are, I'm going someplace. I'm going to move kind of fast because I'm trying to get someplace. And so I encourage you to catch up and keep up with us tonight. And if you miss a part, listen, you can always go back and catch up tonight as you revisit this lesson tonight because it's going to really bless you. Hey, Terry, God bless you. Good to see you. And so what it's saying is that one of the reasons we're suffering defeat is because of our lack of knowledge. And, you know, they had an old saying. They said, what you don't know won't hurt you. That's a lie. That's an absolute lie. It is what you don't know that can really hurt you. You know, if you're not sure who your enemy is, they can be right there in your camp and they'll take you completely down because of your lack of knowledge or unawareness of your enemy. Right. And so it is important that we have a knowledge, a working knowledge of the Word of God and understand not only who God is, but also who God has called us to be. And so if you're taking notes, write this down. We won't be able to do what God has called us to do if we are not confident that God wants to do it through us. Come on. Come on. We're doing notes already, you all. All right. We won't be able to do what God has called us to do if we're not confident that God wants to do it through us. Hey, Michelle, Sister Lillian, bless you. And so listen, how can we allow God to freely use us if we're not sure he wants to use us? All right. How can we be sure that God wants to use us if we are not sure that God wants to use us? Pastor, come on, make that make sense. Understand, if we are not sure that God wants to use us, God can put us in a position to be used, put us in a place where we can become most effective. Watch this now. And because of our lack of understanding that God wants to use us, that God wants to get glory out of our lives, listen, God can't do it because we're not sure that, watch this, one, that God wants to do it, and two, that it can be done. Consider this. What if someone is in front of you and God wants to, let's say they're in a wheelchair, and God wants to heal them? Now, it is obvious, it is clearly seen through the Word of God, 3 John chapter 2, it says, I wish above all that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. And the Word of God is clear that God wants us to be healed, that God wants us to be whole. Now, you are sitting there in front of someone who's either in a wheelchair or going through an affliction, and you want to pray. As a matter of fact, something inside of you is urging you to pray, right? And you know how it is sometimes when you've been urged to pray, something else is saying, what if it don't work? What if it's not God's will? What if God doesn't heal them? I'll tell you what that is. That's the devil. Come on. Because it is clear that God, it is the desire of God that people are made whole, right? That's God's plan. And so our job is to position ourselves so that when God wants to use us, we have to then be aware that God wants to get the glory out of our lives. I'm not sure, you all, why I'm going fuzzy right now. I can't really understand why this is happening. You know, give me a second to clean my camera off. It just went fuzzy. And I can't explain why it did that, but it did. All right, so please forgive my camera. It's acting special tonight. And so if you and I are not sure that God wants to do great things through our lives, we'll continue on through life lethargic and not really knowing, you know, something in us will say, well, I know what it is. It's Holy Spirit. But we'll say something told me to lay hands on them. Something pushed me to pray. But we never move ourselves in position to be used by God. And I'll tell you why. It's because, watch this, we don't believe that God wants to use us. And this is where I'm going tonight with our lesson on tonight, because I want to prove to you by the scripture. Thank you, sir. Appreciate that. That God, watch this, that God really wants to get glory, not out of just my life, but out of your life. Listen, God moving through our lives is not based on a title. right? Whether you're an apostle, whether you're a bishop, whether you're an archapostle, whatever title you hold, God wants this. God wants to get maximum glory out of our lives. And so it is imperative then that we understand that God wants to use us. And you're saying, Pastor, use me after all I've been through? Yes. Come on. Man, listen, every time I read the scripture, God used the most unlikely people. And watch this. He got maximum glory out of their lives. Come on. We look at King David. David was the least likely to be chosen as king of Israel. Watch this. He was least likely to be the one to defeat Goliath, yet he got the victory. He was the one that God chose, watch this now, for that season to affect that generation. Well, guess what? God, by his own divine providence, has you and I here right now in this season. The devil right now is taking us for granted, right? He is taking us for granted. And truth be told, he is making many of God's children feel as though they don't deserve to be used by God. But listen, I beg the differ with the devil. Child of God, the Father wants to use you, right? He wants to get glory out of your life. But if you and I aren't aware, if we lack confidence that God wants to use us, I promise you, God can never get maximum glory out of your potential. Why? Not because he's not God, but because of our lack of understanding or our lack of knowledge, right? And so I told you in our opening lesson on last week that it was vital for you and I to discover three things, right? Number one, discover who you are. Who am I? Come on, I'm more than just a Christian. Come on, I'm more than just somebody that God decided to save. Who am I really? Who am I as God's child? Who am I really? Hey, cuz. And what God wants this now, and what the devil wants to do is make you feel like you are nothing, make you believe you're not worthy, make you feel as though you are nobody in the kingdom of God. And so number one, it's vital that we understand who we are. Number two, understand our value to the kingdom of God. Oh, dear God, if you understood, God called us kings and priests. He said we are his precious jewels. Oh, listen, y'all, I can't wait to get to that part. Oh, dear God, it's going to be good. But understand, one, who we are. Understand how valuable we are to the kingdom of God. And then number three, we must understand the plan of God for our lives to fulfill his purpose. Come on. We must understand the plan of God for us to fulfill. Come on, get this now. His purpose. All right. It is never about our purpose. It's about God's purpose for us. Understand, the Bible says clearly, all that we do in word and deed, it says do all to the glory of God. And so it is then the desire of God that we understand who we are, our value to the kingdom, and his plan for our lives. And I guarantee you, listen, once you realize those three, man, listen, that's a combo meal. Come on, that's a straight number one for McDonald's, all right? Burger, fries, and a pop. Come on, somebody. Once you get that combo meal in your life, I guarantee you the devil will never again have victory in your life. Uncle Herb, God bless you, sir. I guarantee you, I promise you, the devil will never obtain another victory in your life when you understand who you are, how valuable you are, and understand the plan of God for your life in this kingdom, or for his kingdom, glory to God. Because I promise you, listen, when you know who you are, no devil in hell can cause you to take back what you know, right? And once you know a thing, you got it. Come on. But also though, if we don't embrace, though, watch this now, don't miss this. Thomas said a three-piece meal. That's right, a three-piece. But watch this though, if we don't embrace our righteousness, right? Understand, we said on Friday, we have to be willing to embrace our righteousness, not in ourselves, but in Christ Jesus. He is the one who has declared and made us righteous, watch this now, in him. And so it is because of what he's done and what he's paid for on Calvary. Now you and I can be declared or have been made, watch this now, the righteousness of God in in Christ Jesus. Let me see if I can show you an illustration. This is Christ Jesus. This is you and I. As long as we're in him, we are declared righteous because we are in Christ. And so, listen, we are made righteous because of his suffering, because of the blood, because of his death, burial, and resurrection. And so, since you and I have been made righteous, now we must then accept the fact then that God wants you and I to demonstrate our authority through Christ Jesus in the earth. Consider this now. Why would God give you his power? Why would God give you the name of Jesus and not give you the authority or, watch this, give you permission to use it here in the earth realm? Listen, when you and I get to heaven, we don't need the power in heaven. Come on. When we're in heaven for the 1,000-year millennial reign, for 7 years, we will not need that authority. Come on. Listen, we won't have to speak in tongue. We ain't got to prophesy. Your titles won't mean anything once we get the glory. Come on. When we come back down here for 1,000 years to beat the devil, come on, to beat the brakes off the devil and his camp. You still won't need it then because Jesus will be, he will rule with a rod of iron. And so you won't need it then either. So the question is, why then do we need the power? And why then do we need that authority? I'm glad you asked. We need it to function here and now in this season on earth, right? Now watch this. Look at Daniel, if you will. Daniel, the 11th chapter, Daniel chapter 11. Look at verse 32. Daniel 11, look at verse 32, the B part of the verse. See, it is until you and I have a working knowledge that God wants us to demonstrate. And let me make that clear. God wants us to demonstrate his glory in the earth. Listen, Jesus, you all, has gone back to heaven. He has sat down on the right hand of the Father. Now he has commissioned you and I to do his bidding in the earth. But now if you and I don't do it, you can have power, be full of power, but if you don't cut the light switch on, the power is there, but it's ineffective until we cut it on, right? So it is in our spiritual lives. You've been given the power and authority by Almighty God, but until you activate what is in us, until we activate the power of God that resides in our life, all we have is power, but watch this, we don't have no execution. And believe me, God does not want us to be in this earth realm without having the knowledge of how to execute this authority in the earth. Come on, Clay, are you in Daniel 11? Look at verse 32. It says, but the people that do know their God, watch this now, shall be strong and do exploits. Oh, dear God. That's good, y'all. That's good. Catch that now. That's Daniel 11, verse 32, the B part of the verse. He said, but the people, watch this now, that's you and I, who know their God, shall be strong and do exploits. Pastor, what's exploits? Exploits are great works, great deeds. All right? Watch this now. Look at it in the EHV translation. The EHV translation. All right, look at what it says. It says, but the people who know their God, watch this now, will be strong and take action. Woo, come on somebody. Good God Almighty. The people who know their God will be strong and take action. Now, this is where I'm going. Come on. Come on, stay close now. Follow me. Because this is what God wants us to do. I told you in the book of James, it says, be doers of the word, not hearers only. In other words, God desires that you and I take action. Come on, can I get 10 of you all to put in the chat room, take action? Come on. If you ain't busy, come on. I need 10 of you all to put in the chat room, take action. Because this is what the body of Christ is lacking in this season. Come on. In this season, we are lacking action. Come on. We have the power, no action. We have the anointing, but no action. We have the glory on our lives, but we have no action. The Apostle Paul says, show me thy faith by thy works, which means then you and I then must take action, right? Listen, why in the world would God give us this power, but we don't take action? Can you imagine if I gave you my credit card? Don't worry, I'm not. But if I did, if I gave you my credit card and I said, go to the store and buy yourself something. Now, if I check my credit card in 2 weeks, you haven't bought anything, I'm going to assume you don't want to. I will assume you're afraid to, or I assume you lost my card, right? Why? Because you did not take action. Well, listen, if God has given us the power and authority, why aren't we taking more action? Come on, consider this. People in your homes are dying. They're getting sick. Come on, people in your lives are being attacked by the devil. They're under demonic oppression, and the devil is wearing them out. Why? Because God's children are not taking action. The question is, what's wrong? I'll tell you what's wrong. The enemy has convinced us that this thing don't work. Come on. He's convinced us that we're not good enough, right? He's convinced us that we're not worthy enough. But listen, me taking action is not based on me being worthy. Woo, come on, somebody. It's not based on me being worthy. It's based on the worthiness of Jesus, who was the one who paid the price. Come on. He was the supreme sacrifice. He was the spotless Lamb of God. Watch this now. He was the one who deemed me worthy. He was the one who paid the price. He told me, watch this now, to come to God in his name. Oh, come on. He says, if you ask anything in my name, the Father will do it for you, that he will be glorified. He didn't say in my name. Listen, my name don't mean nothing to a lot of folks. Okay, glory to God. Come on. It don't carry a whole lot of weight in a whole lot of circles. But watch this. When I use the name of Jesus, that carries weight. The Bible says, at that name, every knee shall bow. Come on. At that name, every tongue shall confess. Which means then, disease must bow. Cancer must bow. Being paralyzed, it must bow. Being blind, come on, it must bow. Being deaf, come on, it must bow. Being broke, it must bow. Being tormented in your mind, come on, it must bow. Demonic spirits tearing up your world, they must bow. Why? They have to bow to the name of Jesus. But watch this now. Somebody in the earth realm needs to understand their authority, needs to understand their position in God, needs to know who they are, need to know their value to the kingdom, their value to the kingdom of God and God's plan for their lives. Watch this now. And then begin to understand, I sit in the seat of one who has been made righteous by the blood of Jesus. Woo, come on, y'all. It's too early to preach this hard. Come on. Are y'all getting this? Come on. And so it is then at that point we understand that God desires that we take action. Come on. God wants us to take action. Come on. If your child gets sick, don't sit and wait until you get to a doctor. You lay hands on that child and command the devil to let your child go. Come on. But do it in the name of Jesus. Come on. Don't sit there and your body aching, your head hurting. You're saying, well, I'm just getting old. This is old arthritis. The devil is a liar. How come? Listen, there's nothing in the Bible that says I have to receive arthritis. Come on. The Bible says Moses was 120 years old. Watch this. His eyes were not dim. His body was still functioning. And that's at 120. Come on. The ball was just getting started. You mean to tell me that God would choose your 50-year-old self, 60-year-old self, barely turn 80-year-old self, and you come out, well, I guess it's arthritis. The devil is a liar. You command that thing to leave your life and command healing in your life. Why? Because that's your right as a covenant child. Come on. That, him and y'all, that's our right. God has given us the right, watch this now, to use the name of Jesus. Watch this. And even to lay hands on yourself. Praise God. Oh, I can't. I told y'all, listen, I have my bottle of oil every day. I put it on my finger I put it on my tongue and my head. Come on, and I pray for myself. God, keep my body and God, keep my mouth so I don't say the wrong thing. Come on. And I do it every day. Why? Because I believe in the power of prayer. Come on. I believe in laying hands on myself. Come on. Before I pray for you, guess what? I pray for me. Oh, yes, I sure do. Pastor, that's selfish. No, it's not. Glory to God. I promise you, if I'm hurting, I can't pray for you. If I'm in pain, I could, but it probably won't be too effective. And so, listen, I cast the devil out myself. I sure do. I lay hands on me, devil. I command you to leave my body. I command your body come in line with the word. I command you to be healed, be made whole in every area of your life. Yes, I do. I lay hands on me. Listen, which means then you can lay hands on yourself. Listen, quit when you're passed out. Come on, you in the prayer line every Sunday. Come on. Lay hands on yourself and command the devil to let you go in the name of Jesus and forbid him to take control over your life. Watch this. See, Bible says, but a people who know their God will be strong and take action. Pastor, what actions are we to take? Now, turn, if you will, over to Mark's Gospel, chapter 16. Come on, Mark. The 16th chapter. Come on, class. Come on. Mark the 16th chapter. I'm not sure where my verses are tonight. I don't see them coming up on the screen, but that's fine. We'll go. Keep on going. Mark 16, look at verse number 17. All right. Mark 16, look at verse number 17. It says, and these signs shall follow them that believe. Woo! Look, y'all, these are the words of the Lord. Come on. These are the words of Jesus. If you don't believe what I say, at least, listen, can you all believe what Jesus said? Come on. Come on now. I'm going to talk back church today. Can you all at least believe what Jesus said? He says, these signs shall follow them that believe. What? Now, watch this now. Your actions are an outward demonstration of how you believe. Come on now. Your actions are an outward demonstration of how you really believe. You can't tell me I believe, but do nothing. Come on. You can't tell me I believe that I can grow collard greens in the backyard, but you won't plant a seed in the backyard. Come on. You can't tell me I believe in the power of prayer, but you won't pray. You can't tell me I believe in the word, but you won't read the word. Come on, somebody. Jesus says, these signs shall follow them that believe. Watch this now. He says, in my name, come on, action, they shall cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongue. Come on, verse 18. They shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. Come on. They shall lay hands on the sick. Right there. Come on. Somebody say action. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Who, Pastor? The sick shall recover. Come on. And look at verse 19. He says, so then, after the Lord spoke unto them, he was received up into heaven, and watch this, y'all. He sat down on the right hand of God. Why did Jesus go back to heaven and sit down on the right hand of God? I'll tell you why. Because in this earth, he had nothing else to do. He says, now this is what you and I are supposed to do. Let's look at it again. He says, if you are a believer, and I believe you are, he says, signs are supposed to follow your life and my life. Oh, can you imagine that Jesus said that the signs are and wonders are supposed to be attached to the lives of believers? As a matter of fact, one of the ways unbelievers will recognize you as a believer is because they see the power, watch this now, working in our lives. As a matter of fact, let me give you a different phrase. I preached this about a year or two ago. I said, God wants you and I to represent him. Woo! Come on, class, get this. That God wants you and I to represent him. Pastor, come on, make that make sense. If I were to introduce you to somebody, and if time had passed, and if I were not sure that you all ever met, what I would do then is represent you. I would reintroduce you. Well, guess what? God wants you and I to reintroduce Jesus to the earth. Woo! Oh, yes, amen. God wants you and I, me and you, us and we, to reintroduce, to represent Christ to the earth. Come on, how, Pastor Larry? I'm glad you asked. Y'all are good class. In power and in demonstration. Come on, class. In power and in demonstration. Understand, Jesus says, you are the light of the world, right? That's you and I. He says, we are the light of the world. We're a city that sits on the hill that cannot be hid. Watch this now. What it means that I've separated you. I've put you on a hill. Watch this now. Well, the devil can't get to you, but your light is supposed to be shining. And so as you and I begin to represent Christ to the world, watch this now, they now get to see Christ live through our lives. And what that does is they now get to see his power work through you and I. Listen, you all hear me. It's more than just coming to church on Sunday. Come on. It's more than just hearing me on this other stream. But when I talk about demonstrating the power of God, it means then that you and I get to be conduits in the earth. Now, watch this now. Jesus said, these signs are supposed to follow you. Come on. If you believe, the question, watch this now, the question becomes then, do you believe? Come on. Are you simply a church goer, a church attender, or do you actually believe? Because listen, there are some folk who hear the word, but they don't believe it. Come on. They'll dance, they'll shout over the word, but they don't believe it. Now, I can tell whether you believe it or not. Watch this now. Because if you believe it, you will act on it. Come on. You will say what the word says, and you will do what the word says to do. But if I don't believe it, I won't say it, and I won't act on it. See, if you tell me, Pastor Larry, meet me at my house at 3 o'clock. I've made dinner for your family. Come pick it up. Oh, I guarantee you. Now, I ain't throwing shade. You don't have to fix me dinner. But I'm using it for purposes of illustration. If you said be there at 3 o'clock, guess what? I'll be there at 10 minutes to 3. You know why? Because I want you to know that I believe what you said. And I'll prove it to you by showing up at your house. And it is my showing up that shows you I believe what you said. Well, Jesus says, you shall lay hands on the sick. The question becomes, why aren't we laying hands on the sick? Is it because we don't believe? Come on, Junebug, Shaquita, and them, and your family, listen, they're sick. How come you aren't praying? Come on, people in your family are being stricken down with diseases and sicknesses, but you're not praying. So the question becomes, do you believe what the word says? Come on, are you willing to lay hands on them and command that sickness to leave their bodies? Come on. Listen, you don't have to be a pastor to pray. Come on, a missionary, a church mother, an evangelist. Listen, you've been commissioned by God to lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Let me keep reading the text. Watch, he says, in my name, you shall cast out devils. Oh, come on. Listen, which means then, the devil is trespassing in your house, on your body, illegally. Oh, somebody better catch that. Come on, somebody better catch that right there. If the devil is in your home, in your head, in your money, in your marriage, you've been given the right here in the text, by Jesus himself, to cast that joker out your life. Come on. You can command him to leave, and guess what? He's got to flee. Can you imagine telling the devil and his imps to get up off me? Come on. Devil, you got to go. I don't care where you go, but you got to get up out of here. Come on, somebody. I've been preaching y'all this Sunday and last Sunday. Hold up. Wait a minute. You better learn how to invite God in it. Come on, somebody. You better learn how to tell the devil in the name of Jesus, get up out of my life. Come on, get off my body. Get off my cousin. Get off Junebug and him. You, listen, you got to go and believe what you say. Watch this. Then it says, they shall speak with new tongues. Oh, listen. This is why sometimes, y'all, I just go straight in the Holy Ghost. Because when I pray in the Holy Ghost, I am going for the devil's jugular. Oh, yes, I am. When I pray in the Holy Ghost, I am going for the devil's jugular. I intend to take that joker all the way out. Y'all hear me tonight? Come on. Because watch this. When I pray in the Holy Ghost, I am praying the perfect prayer, right? My pastor, I don't understand what I'm praying. I don't have to. I ain't talking to me. I'm talking to God. And so when I pray in the Holy Ghost, I am praying the perfect prayer. Watch this. I am praying the perfect prayer. I am praying just what it takes. Thank you, Barbara. So the Bible, to kick the devil out of my life, right? Because I am saying by way of the Holy Ghost exactly what God wants to hear, right? And so he says, you shall speak with new tongues. Watch this now. Verse 18, you shall take up serpents. Now, it don't mean you go and go try to find a snake. No, that ain't what it's saying. But if you grab one by accident, he says, like Paul, if he bites you, it won't hurt you. Come on. Paul got bit by a snake, and guess what? Paul shook it off. Come on. When the devil comes and try to bite your life, you do what, Pastor? I shake it off. Why? Because the devil, that slew foot serpent, is attacking your life, but you must, come on, shake it off. Why? He says, it shall not hurt you. But then he says, they shall lay hands on the sick. Notice the verbiage. You shall lay hands on the sick, and they, the sick, shall recover. Come on, somebody. And so understand, God desires then that you and I do what he did in the earth. God wants to get the glory and the honor out of our lives as you and I represent the power of God in the earth. Watch this now. To those who need hands laid on them. Now, I made a statement. Let me be clear. Many of us spend our time trying to be wonders in the church. See, watch this. We don't have to be wonders in the church. Because if you're a Christian, you should already be believing. But when the unbelievers come to church, our job is to pray for them, watch this now, and allow God to prove himself through us to them. Come on, y'all. Are you following me? God wants us to prove his power. He wants to do it through us to them to prove that his power works. Right? Listen, now, yes, you can pray for a person who's already saved. Yes, you can, and they'll get healed too. But God wants us to show the sinners more than the saints. If you're already a believer, you should already know it works. Right? Why? Because the word saved you. And there is no greater miracle than the miracle of salvation. Right? And so if it worked through you, hey, cuz, if it worked for you, on you, that's the greatest miracle that can ever happen in our lives, that God saved us. But watch this. He also wants to heal those in the house. Come on. Have power for the house and those who are not in the house, so those who aren't in the house can come to the house. Are you following me? Now, this, you all, won't happen. Our point one was, we must embrace the reality of our relationship with God and who we are in him. Come on. We must embrace the reality of our relationship with God and who we are to him. See, online in the chat room, I see my mother, I see my uncle, I see my wife, I see my cousins. Come on, I see folks who say they love me. Now, they're online tonight. I see that, at least I see their names, and I know who they are in relationship to me. Why? Because I know them. Watch this. When we embrace the reality of our relationship to God, come on, and who we are to him and in him, man, listen, we can get the job done. See, watch this. Over in Romans, look at Romans. Romans, the 8th chapter. Look at Romans 8, verse 14. Romans 8, look at verse 14. Watch this. It says, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, watch this now, they are the sons of God. If you got a pen, put it in your Bible, the sons of God, okay? Highlight it, the sons of God, right? Look at verse 15. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit, watch this, you all, of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. That means Daddy God. Okay, you and I, who've been adopted, we cry, Daddy God, okay, or Abba, Father. Look at verse 16. The Spirit, as the Holy Spirit in you that resides in all of us as believers, it says, the Spirit itself should be himself, beareth witness with our spirit that watcheth now that we are the children of God. Now, notice the words, you all, the words children of God and the word adoption. Come on, children of God and adoption, which means then if you and I have been adopted, it means number one, we've been chosen on purpose. Come on, if you are going to adopt somebody, you don't just go any, many, mighty, more or give me anyone you want. No, when you've been adopted, you go and you pick the one you want. See, the greatest part about being a child that's adopted, the parent who had you may not have wanted you. And listen, to be told, maybe them giving you up was the best thing for you. But the person who picked you, watch this now, the person who picked you, they picked you on purpose. Come on. And not only did they pick you on purpose, but watch this. All the rights and, come on somebody, the rights and privileges of being adopted, watch this now, are yours. Which means then, once they sign those papers and it goes through the custody of the state, whatever belongs to them belongs to you. Oh, somebody catch this. Come on. You got to hear this now. Whatever is attached to them is attached to you. Whatever is in their house now belongs to you. Come on. Whatever, listen, whatever authority they have now belongs to you. Why? Because you have been adopted into the family. And so it means they've chosen me, but watch this now. They have accepted me as their own. Come on, y'all, catch this now. They have accepted you as their own, which means now, because you picked me, because you've accepted me, that means I have all rights and privileges. You saying, Pastor, please give me some Bible. Y'all are good class. I'm glad you asked. Look over in Ephesians now. Ephesians chapter 1. Look at verse number 6. Okay? Because understand, we've been chosen in him. Consider this. Out of all the folks in your family, God chose you. Come on. Out of all the folks on your block, God chose you. Come on, Jesus says, you did not choose me, but I have chosen, you got it, you. Come on, anybody glad God picked you? Woo, come on. Listen, I know a lot of folk, y'all didn't make it, but thank God I said yes to them, right? And so over in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 6, y'all, look at what it says. It says, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein, watch this now, he hath made us accepted in the beloved. Woo, somebody better get this in. Pastor Larry, who is the beloved? Jesus. You recall when he was being baptized, God says, this is my beloved son. Come on. In whom I am well pleased. Jesus then is the beloved. And so if he then is the beloved, I have been accepted in him. Woo, y'all come on. Come on, y'all. Catch this tonight. Now, in the W.E. translation, okay? The W.E. translation. Pastor, what's that? The W.E. is the Worldwide English Translation, okay? The W.E. translation. Look at what it says. Y'all, you're going to shout now, okay? You can, come on. Get a little room. You're getting ready to shout right now. Look at what it says. It says, praise him. His kindness is great and wonderful. We have been accepted by God through Jesus Christ, whom he loved so much. Woo, come on, somebody, catch that now. He said, because of his kindness is great and wonderful. You and I have been accepted by God through, watch this now, or because of Christ Jesus, whom he loved. Now, look at what I got out of that. God had reason to not like us. Come on. Can anybody besides me find a reason or two why God should not have loved us? Come on. Hey, Lillian, where is my sister Anita? I haven't seen her at all tonight. Where's she at? She working? Tell her I said, God bless her. I miss her tonight. Watch this now. And so if Jesus then has caused us to be accepted through him, that means that everything we get now, you all, watch this now, comes through Christ Jesus. Which means then, you can't even function in any area you don't believe you have the right to be in. Woo, come on, catch this, class. You cannot function. Hear me. You cannot function in an area you don't believe you have the right to be in. See, watch this. If you were, in a grocery store, and someone asks you the price of an item, you can't give them a price because you don't work there. Come on, if somebody said, ring me out, because they saw you standing by the register, and they said, come on, ring me out. You can't do it. Why? Because you don't have the right to be there. Well, guess what? If you and I don't believe we have the right to lay hands and catch, hey, T, if we don't believe we have the right to be there, to be in this position, then when somebody is sick in our world, watch this now, we won't even have the faith to pray. Now, it's amazing. We have the faith to ask somebody else to pray. Now, I'm not saying don't ask other folk to pray. My question is, how come you won't pray? Now, when you invite someone else in to pray, Bible did say, if any two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything they shall ask, it shall be done unto them that the Father is glorified. Right? And so we should get somebody else to pray. Bless your heart. And so watch this now. Yes, we can ask someone else to pray. But watch this. You better have confidence in your own prayer. Come on. You better have confidence in you praying. What if the person you call to pray don't feel like praying that day? All right? The person you call to pray isn't available. Then what? Does someone get sick and die because we don't pray? No, child of God, you better learn how to pray for yourself. But you can't be effective if you don't believe you have the right to function from that position. See, watch this. When you stand to pray and you're praying the prayer of faith, you need to be praying knowing that you're in relationship with God who is doing the work. Come on. Come on, listen, come on, class. Say, I'm in relationship with God. Come on, repeat it. Come on, say, I'm in relationship with God. Come on, you have to understand that you and I, we are in relationship with God. See, watch this. Look at Psalm 82. Come on, Psalm 82, look at verse 6. Y'all, come on. I'm going to help you understand who you are, right? Tonight, I only want to help you understand who you are as it pertains to being in right standings and relationship with God. Because if you don't know, you won't walk in it. See, I understand who I am as far as with my mother. Guess what? I have a key to her house. I know her alarm code. I know all her business. Why? Because of our relationship, right? And so she tell me things I ain't going to tell you because of our relationship, right? And so is with you and God. You are God's child. Come on, are you on Psalm 82? Come on, Psalm 82, look at verse 6. Come on, class. Watch this, it says, I have said, watch this now, I have said, ye are God's. And all of you, watch this now, children, uh-oh, wait a minute now. Come on, children of the Most High. Oh, come on, come on. Y'all see it? Come on now. You can don't fight. Come on, I'm the messenger. It's in the Bible. Come on, you don't want to believe it, but you can't take it out the Bible. It says, I have said, ye are gods, not Jehovah God, but little gods in the earth. And all of you are children, come on, underline, of the Most High. Who is the Most High? God Yahweh, God Jehovah. You, come on, are a child of God. Come on. Watch this. In the CEV translation, look, y'all, look at what it says. In the CEV translation, it says, I, the Most High God, say that all of you are gods. Woo-hoo-hoo! Come on, y'all. It says, I, the Most High God, say that all of you are gods and also my own children. Woo, listen, let me come down your road and make that make sense. See, if you read Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26, God says, let us make man. Watch this now, the next phrase, in our image, in our likeness, and let them have dominion. Now, when you made your child, come on, your child should look like you. Your child should carry some of your characteristics. Come on, come on. It's that mama's baby, daddy's maybe. Come on, have you ever seen a child that looked just like their daddy? I'll tell you why. Because watch this now, they came from their daddy. Woo, come on, y'all. You are children of the Most High God, and you've been birthed. Watch this. You come from your father, who is God, right? And so if I come from God, and watch this, he is a spirit. Guess what? You and I are spirits, which means then you are not God, Jehovah, but you are gods in the earth. Oh, Pastor, prove it. Pastor, prove it. Watch this. The Bible says the earth has God given to the children of men. And so if God then gave the earth to us, question, why then did God give us the earth? To dominate. Ooh, look at that. Earpiece fell out of my ear. Praise the Lord. God gave us this earth for you and I to dominate and to have dominion in the earth. Pastor, I ain't convinced yet. Watch this here. Look at St. John chapter 1. Come on, class. St. John chapter 1. Y'all working me hard tonight. Good God Almighty. St. John chapter 1. Look at verse 12. Come on. St. John chapter 1. Look at verse number 12. It says, but as many as receive him. Come on, class. To them, that's you and I, to them gave he the power to become, come on, right here, there it is, the sons of God, even to them, come on, That word again, that believe on his name. I'll say it again. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Y'all, I feel like preaching now. I'm trying to tell you. Look at the same verse, you all, in the CEB translation. Okay, the same verse, John 1, verse 12, in the CEB translation. Watch this. It says, but those who did welcome him, come on, those who believed in his name, he authorized to become God's children. Oh, good God Almighty. Now, watch this now. If God then authorized you, anybody God authorized, watch this now, they become authorized to do what? Carry the same authority. In other words, God gave us the power to act on his behalf. Woo, come on, somebody. Y'all getting this? He gave us the power. He authorized us to act on his behalf. Let me see if I can give you a different word. The power of attorney. Come on, the power of attorney. He has given us the power, the authority to act on his behalf. Let me see if I can make this make sense. If I allow someone to preach in the pulpit on a given Sunday because I was not going to be there, the assistant pastors, hey, pastor, bless you, sir. The assistant pastors have been given permission to act on my authority, watch this, in my absence, right? They can do what I could do if I were there, right? Because they've been given permission, watch this now, to hold the title of pastor in my place. Now, watch this. It does not mean that I'm dead. It means that, watch this, I am no longer present. And so because they have, they've been given permission to act on my behalf, they can make decisions, come on my behalf as though I were there. Watch this now, let me make it make sense to you. Because Jesus now is sitting down at the right hand of the Father, he went away and said, whatever you ask, in my name, it shall be done. He says, I'm not here in body, but I'm here in position. Come on. I have given you my name. I've given you the authority, and whoever you lay hands on in my name, he said, my Father will do it. Why? Because you stand in my name. Watch this now. Representing me. Come on. You are now representing me to people. Say, I lay hands on you in the name of Jesus, and I command you to be healed. I am representing Jesus to that individual who needs a touch from God. Right? And so God says now, I've given you the power to act on my behalf. Now, let's go back to Romans, the 8th chapter. All right? Let's go back to Romans 8. Look at verse 16. It says, the Spirit himself, or itself, beareth witness with our spirit that we are children of God. Right? Now, look at verse 17. It says, and if children, then heirs of, oh, y'all, I'm getting ready to shout by myself. If children, then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. It says, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. Now, watch this, y'all. Oh, dear God, y'all, I got to go. But let me give you this. It says, so what then does it mean then to be an heir? All right? In the Greek, there's a Greek word for heir that means a receiver of an inheritance, right? A beneficiary. That's what an heir is. The inheritance now comes because, watch this now, we said yes to Jesus. Woo, come on, somebody. The reason we have a right to the authority, the right to the power, is not because of us, but because we said yes to Jesus. Now, being an heir of God means we inherit what God has. Come on now. We inherit all that heaven has to offer. But now being a joint heir with Christ means that we have equal share. Come on, somebody. We have equal share with Christ by reason of our relationship. Oh, good God Almighty. By reason, y'all, of our relationship with the Father. Come on, somebody. Man, listen, you don't want to miss when y'all, I got to go. I got to get out of here. But we've been given all rights and privileges, hear me, from God Almighty to do the bidding of Christ Jesus right here in the earth. Why? Because of our position, hear me, because of our position with Christ. You and I, as children of God, hear me, you all, can you imagine that the reason God saved us so that he could have a bunch of, watch this now, a bunch of anointed ones. So that he could have a bunch of anointed ones in the earth. Come on, that's you and I, a bunch of Christos in the earth. That's you and I, those who are carriers of the anointing. Come on, those of us who are carriers of the glory, those of us who are carriers of the power of God, those of us who are, watch this, who can command and be obeyed. Come on, we are the carriers of that anointing, all right? And so watch this now. God says, all I need is someone in the earth. Yo, I gotta go. All I need is someone in the earth who would dare to believe me. Come on. God said, all I need is someone in the earth who would dare believe me. Come on. All I need is someone in the earth who would be bold and be willing to be a doer. Hear me. To be a doer of the word. Y'all, I can't get off that. God desires that we become doers of the word. Are y'all hearing me tonight? God desires that you and I become doers of the word. Listen, not just hearers only, but become doers. Man, listen, my pastor, what if it don't work? What if it does? Pastor, what if they don't believe me? I believe Romans 4 says, so what if they don't believe? Come on, listen. Their unbelief does not make the word of God of no effect. But watch this. I want to say Romans chapter 12. I want to say either verse 2 or verse 3. It says that we may prove. The last part of the verse, it says that we may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. God, watch this, God, you all, wants us to prove that this thing works. Can you imagine? Man, if we ever believe this thing, we go turn the hospitals out. Come on. We would go down to these places, man, and folks would get free from addictions right away. But it's going to require that you and I understand our position. Y'all, listen, y'all, my time is up, y'all. I'm overtime already. Y'all, listen, we're going to pick up right there tomorrow. I'm sorry, right there Wednesday night to prove to you that you and I are heirs of Christ Jesus. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ Jesus, which means then that whatever heaven has to offer, you and I have a right to it. Come on, good God Almighty. Listen, y'all, it's in the word. It's in the word. Somebody has got to be bold and preach this thing. Come on. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. If you're at home, lay hands on your spouse. Lay hands on your kids. Lay hands on your dog. Come on. You have to believe this word. Listen, you got to get some practice in. Begin practicing at your house. Come on. Lay hands on yourself. Glory to God. Amen. And command your body to be healed. Come on. Command your body to obey the word of God. Glory to God. Come on. And watch God do what he does. Amen. In the middle of this pandemic, watch the hand of God be released and revealed, you all, as never before. Listen, y'all, I got to stop. I got to stop because there is so much in me that I want to give to you tonight. I tell you, man, I feel the Holy Ghost, y'all. I feel the presence of God right now real strong. And so if I don't stop, I'll keep right on going, but I got to stop. Listen, don't miss Wednesday night. Listen, you want to be on early Wednesday night. I tell you what, you don't want to miss it. All right. I'll be right here if the Lord stay the same. And listen, just be here Wednesday night. All right. I want y'all listen tonight. I won't do any music. I'm going to just close out tonight. Come on. Let's pray. Father of heaven, I pray that tonight, Father, the word tonight was received. And I pray in the name of Jesus, God, that your sons and your daughters will begin to realize who they are and who we are in you. And God, as we begin to walk in that authority and walk in that power, that your name will once again be revered in the earth, and people will see the signs, the wonders, and the miracles in these last days. And I decree and declare by the power of God that your name will be great, and your name once again will reign supreme, and your glory and your power will be shown in the earth as your children, God, represent you to the world. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Aren't y'all, God bless you all. All right, for real, I got to go this time. I love you all. Big hugs to all of you all. I love you so much. Thank you all for being here. I pray that tonight you get sweet rest tonight. I pray that God will continue to bless your life. All right. I pray the blessing of the Lord will make it rich and add no sorrow. Thank you all for being a blessing to us right here, our giving information. Thank you all so much for your continued gifts and your acts of love. I bless God for all of you all being here to support us. And listen, because you're here, that's why I'm here. So thank you, thank you, thank you, and thank you so much. All right, y'all, I got to get out of here. I love you all my heart. All right, I'll see you all again. We say, those of us who have a gut kind of faith, we call those things that be not as though they were. And we realize that God has you and I in the palm of his hand. All right, y'all, got to go. God bless you. I love you so much. I'll see you Wednesday night right here at 6:55. Don't forget, tomorrow is our prayer. All right, tomorrow is prayer. Call our prayer conference line, all right, and be a part of our prayer tomorrow. All right, call the prayer conference on tomorrow at 10 o'clock. All right, y'all. Love you. Gotta go. Be blessed.